días, bienvenidos. Gracias a todos por su participación. En primer lugar, quería agradecer a Abbott en su departamento de neurociencias y a Interacoustics, con su representante en Argentina, GAES. Gracias a ellos, este evento pudo ser posible. También quiero agradecer a la buena predisposición de todos los invitados nacionales para sumarse. Y va a ser un honor para nosotros, el departamento de neurotología de Fleni, invitar a. Es un placer y un honor. Michael se formó en la Universidad de Westfalia, Alemania, y en Rochester, Nueva York. Comenzó su investigación en neurofisiología en Baylor College y en Houston, en Montpellier y en Múnich, donde finalmente se estableció. Él forma parte del departamento de neurología del Centro de Vértigo y Equilibrio del departamento de la Universidad de Múnich. Él es un apasionado de la docencia, tiene el principal interés en la investigación de los tratamientos de los trastornos vestibulares, oculomotores y cerebelosos. Sus principales logros en la investigación fueron demostrar la utilidad de la rehabilitación vestibular en la falla vestibular aguda, el uso de corticoides en la neuritis vestibular, el uso de drogas para el tratamiento del nistagmo como las aminopiridinas y en las ataxias, la corsaxona también para el tratamiento del nistagmo y la incorporación de la leucina para el tratamiento de la ataxia y el Niemann-Pick. Y recientemente desarrolló unos anteojos muy livianos y prácticos para la evaluación del nistagmo. Él es referente y está muy involucrado en la clasificación internacional de enfermedades vestibulares, donde forma parte y es cabeza de dos grupos de trabajo. Y es autor de 374 publicaciones en PubMed y participó en 5 libros de la especialidad, tanto en vestibular como en trastornos oculomotores y cerebelosos. Además de eso, actualmente es miembro del comité editorial de Frontier of Neurology en la subespecialidad de neurotología. Forma parte del comité editorial de la revista Journal of Neurology y del staff de editorial de la revista Neurology. Recibió muchos premios clínicos y científicos, incluido el Halpike Nielsen Award en 2016, y, como había dicho, que es un profesor apasionado, recibió el premio a Mejor Maestro por la Sociedad Neurológica Alemana. Michael, bienvenido.
Estimados colegas, buenos días, bienvenidos. Aquí un honor y placer. Por mi grupo de Monarch de Alemania. Muchas gracias, Alfredo. Thank you very much for your kind introduction. Muchas gracias, Carlos, from Interacoustics. Muchas gracias, Victoria, from Abbott, for supporting this event. Porque Miguelito habla muy poco español. Voy a continuar en inglés now. So next time I will take Spanish at school and then I give my lectures in your very important language. The introduction was so good by Alfredo that I think I can only disappoint you. So nevertheless, I will try to deliver a good show to make it interactive so that you can increase your knowledge and improve your skills on how to correctly diagnose and treat your patients up to date. And Alfredo has designed a wonderful program, so it will cover all the relevant areas on vertigo and dizziness. And I have the pleasure to give you, as we say in Spanish, actualidades en el diagnóstico y tratamiento del vértigo y mareo. So I will give you an update, but I will also focus on the basics, because it's very important that everybody keeps on board. We do not want to lose anybody during today's tour, and therefore I will start with the background. So the essentials, how to take patient history, how to examine the patient, how to discriminate in an acute vestibular syndrome, a peripheral from a central lesion. And then we will focus on the Clasificación Internacional by the Barani Society. So we have been working now for exactly 10 years. 13 papers have been published, which, as you will see, make your life much easier in your clinical practice. I will talk a little bit about the examinis de laboratorio, but this will be a particular lecture in the afternoon, and also about trastornos vestibulares periféricos, what is new and what I'm not going to talk about in the afternoon. So this is one of the key slides, because it gives you an overview how to properly diagnose vertigo and dizziness. Symptomas muy frecuentes, of course, the lifetime prevalence of vertigo y mareo is 30%, and it's easy to diagnose based on 4 questions, based on 5 bedside examination, and if a patient has acute vestibular syndrome, there are cinque signos para diferenciar periférico de central. We have only 8 frequent disorders, 4 therapeutic principles, and 8 groups of pharmaceutical agents. And Sir William Osler, he was born in Canada, then he worked in Oxford, and finally ended up in Baltimore, already made the most important statement. Si escuchas atentamente al paciente, le tira el diagnóstico. So your patient is your primary source information. There's no one better who can tell you the diagnosis. And therefore, for your clinical practice, I highly recommend don't look into the files. Sit in front of the patient, be open-minded, and ask the patient, what are your major complaints? Why do you come to our hospital? And then the patient will tell you the diagnosis. Secondly, nowadays, many patients go into the internet, look at the diagnostic criteria, and they know what they have. So that can be challenging for you. And thirdly, what I realized, many patients do take a video of their eye movements during an attack of vertigo, and they bring the video with you. So this has turned out to be a very helpful tool. We take a lot of videos of what we are eating and send it everywhere by WhatsApp. But using your smartphone, and recommend it to the patients, when you have an attack, look at your eye movements and send it to me by WhatsApp. So I have a huge collection of videos from patients with various diseases. And then you can properly say this is that or that. For instance, Meniere's disease, if the nystagmus reads to the left, 5 minutes later to the right, this can only be Meniere's disease. Vestibular paroxysmia, if you see a nystagmus during attack, this will not be a panic attack. So it's very important, and also for the diagnosis of VPPD, that the patients do the diagnostic maneuver, they take a video, and they send it to you. Then you know it's right or left, horizontal posterior canal. So a very simple tool. And another thing which has turned out to be important when we elaborate this is there are also audiogramma which the patients can use, and it's required for Meniere's disease that you document an impaired hearing related to an attack. So if a patient measures his hearing ability before an attack and during an attack, it's most helpful. So just make use of these simple tools. Everybody has it, and we should make the best of it. So now coming back to systematic patient history, there are 4 aspects. And this is similar to headache. Most important, as you will see in a few moments, is the time course. Then the tipo, vertigo rotatorio, indicates a dysfunction of a semicircular canal or pathways from semicircular canals. Why? Because semicircular canals sense angular acceleration. And the leading symptom is vertigo rotatorio. What is more ambiguous is disequilibrio postural or mareo. This is something you can see in patients with functional dizziness, with vestibulopatia bilateral, patients with mareo cerebelloso. So this is more ambiguous, but patients often can nicely discriminate. Here you see a lot of factors which can modify or induce the symptoms. So one question is, for instance, how do you feel when you lie down, when you sit, when you stand, when you walk, when you run, in darkness and on uneven ground? These are the key questions for vestibulopatia bilateral. Then there are other questions. Do the symptoms occur by changes of head or body position? Do the symptoms occur during sneezing, pressing, coughing, lifting heavy weights, typical of syndrome del dehiscencia del canal superior? Social situations, alcohol, sports, typical of mareo funcionalis, and during daytime changes are also important. Why? Patients with mareo funcionalis, they have less symptoms in the early morning. Patients with downbeat nystagmus, they have more symptoms in the early morning. So these key questions. And finally, symptoms accompagnantes, arising from the ear, typical of migrania vestibular, including the question, do you or did you ever suffer from migraine? Ask for central accompanying symptoms explicitly, and nausea e vomitum are unspecific. And here you see also the impact of the international classification on the time course of the symptoms and the correct diagnosis. So patients can present with ataques, patients can have an acute vestibular syndrome, or symptomas persistentes. If a patient has attacks, the next question should be, what is the minimum and the maximum of the duration? And here you see quantitative data based on the classification. If it's less than 1 minute, it can be BPPV, paroxysmia vestibular, e syndrome de dehiscencia del canal superior. Minutes to hours, migrania vestibular, enfermedad de Meniere, and rarely episodic ataxia type 2. More difficult are those patients with an acute vestibular syndrome, because this can be central or peripheral. And then you have to systematically examine the patient, as I will show in a few moments. And patients doctors most often don't like at all are those with long-lasting symptoms. But this can be vestibulopatia bilateral, mareo funcional, e enfermedades neurodegenerativas. In particular, cerebellum, I will point out on that later. And the neurologists are the best people to diagnose cerebellosum, mareo cerebellosum. Now, you do the examination. It's a very systematic approach. We have two basic questions. Is there a deficit? And if there is a deficit, will it be peripheral or central? Here you see the five important clinical aspects of the examination. You have to differentiate a peripheral from a central nystagmus. You can use these glasses, for instance. You have to perform the head impulse test, but as I will show you later, the bedside head impulse test is really bad. So if you see many patients with vertigo dizziness, it's nowadays necessary, it's a must to have a video head impulse test. There's no plan B. Otherwise, you cannot properly diagnose your patient. And this is also something which we use in the classification papers to quantify the VOR gain. Prober Bucket test, I'll talk about later. Very sensitive test for an acute unilateral lesion. Maniobras positionales have to be done in every patient, independent of the history. In particular, elderly subjects, they have BPPV. They avoid changes of head and body position. You will never diagnose that based on the patient history, but on your examination. And finally, Prober Romberg, it indicates you a sensory deficit. If a patient sways much more with the eyes closed, either of the vestibular and or the somatosensory system. So, and now we have these difficult patients. You see here in the MRI, a very small lesion, and here in the diffusion-weighted MRI, in the area of the vestibular nuclei. And they present with acute vestibular syndrome. And then you have to discriminate. And here are the five los cinco grandes, which allow you a discrimination between peripheral and central lesion with a sensitivity and a specificity of about 90%. You look for a deviation obliqua by doing the alternate cavity test. You look whether a nystagmus is suppressed by visual fixation or not. There's one clear statement. If a nystagmus, be alert, is not suppressed by visual fixation, it will not be a peripheral nystagmus. This sounds complicated, but it's true. If a nystagmus is not suppressed by visual fixation, it will not be a peripheral nystagmus. This statement implies that you have patients with a central nystagmus in a brainstem lesion, who can suppress the nystagmus? So be careful. So the correct statement, if a nystagmus is not suppressed by visual fixation, it will not be peripheral. Another thing is to look for a gaze-evoked nystagmus in a patient with acute vertigo and a spontaneous nystagmus. Then you have to look into the opposite direction. Otherwise, there's just an increase of the spontaneous nystagmus. So if a patient has a spontaneous nystagmus to the right, you have to examine him while looking to the left. Here again, head impulse, acute vertigo, central versus peripheral. If the head impulse test is normal, it will not be peripheral. Correct? Because there are patients with a central lesion who have a pathological head impulse test. If the lesion affects the fascicular part of the nerve and or the vestibular nucleus. So if it's normal, it will not be peripheral. That's a correct statement. And finally, if a patient is not able to stand unaided, that's also a sign. Good. If you like, you can take a photograph of this slide, because this is very important for your clinical practice. It shows you the 13 aspects of the clinical examination, and here in green, the red flags indicating a central lesion. And just go systematically through that in every patient, and you will not miss anything. Okay, now we move over to the therapy. We have four aspects: physiotherapia, pharmacotherapia, psychotherapia, and very rarely, chirurgia. And these are the eight groups of drugs which you can use, and we will later talk about the pharmacotherapy. So, antivertiginous drug, if they are sedatives, don't give them longer than 3 days. Anti-inflammatorios for vestibulopatia aguda unilateral. Beta-histina, enfermedad de Meniere. Beta-blocker, topiramate, migraña vestibular. Antidepresivos, SRI for functional dizziness. Anticonvulsivos for vestibular paroxysmia. I recommend lacosamide, as you will see later. Aminopyridine for cerebellar diseases, as already Alfredo mentioned, Tanganil for cerebellar ataxias. Okay, and now a quick update on the classification and a little bit on the examination. So these are the papers which have been published or which are just under revision. So most of the diseases are already covered. There's a delay with the vestibulopatia aguda unilateral, but otherwise, you can download all these papers for free from this website. Just take a photograph and you can easily download that for free. Some of the papers are not yet available, and therefore I give you the details in advance. So we have classified orthostatic diffiness. It sounds a little bit trivial, but there has to be a classification. It's very easy. So 5 or more episodes of dizziness, which are triggered by changes of body position. But it took 1 year to agree with all the people on these criteria. And you have to document orthostatic hypotension or postural tachycardia syndrome or syncope, things like that. But these are the criteria for that. Then we have now ready the diagnostic criteria for presbyvestibulopathy. So we have presbyacusis, we have presbyopia, and we had a hard discussion how to call this frequent entity, and fortunately we ended up with presbyvestibulopatia, which is logical. So it's a Greek term, presbyvestibulopatia. It makes really sense, and you can translate it into Spanish in the same way, into French and English and German. So it's multilingual terminology. And these are the patients who come with postural imbalance and dizziness, but they do not qualify for vestibulopatia bilateral. And they may end up with vestibulopatia bilateral, but we don't know. And here you see how important the video head impulse is. So we agreed on a VOR gain between 0.6 and 0.8 bilaterally. So this is the gray zone between normal function and impaired function. The symptoms are similar to vestibulopatia bilateral, and the patients have to be older than 60 years. So this is now the agreement on. Then what is very frequent here, due to the Rio de la Plata, mild debarkement syndrome. Again, that was a hard fighting. And in the end, it's like a good whiskey. After 16 years, you have a little small amount, but this tastes tolerably well. And the same is also here for the mal de Barthelmont syndrome. So they're not published yet. They're still a little bit under review. So it's postural imbalance, non-spinning vertigo. And of course, it has to be induced by exposure to passive motion. So traveling by speedboat to Montevideo is often not sufficient. Making a cruise in the Caribbean is a good way to get it. Symptoms temporarily reduce with re-exposure to passive motion, because the basic of this disease is very simple. You calibrate to the slow movement on board, and then when you're on firm ground, you have difficulties to recalibrate. That's the mechanism. So if you're a good calibrator, it can be a disadvantage. And it often ends in functional dizziness. So we have transient and persistent and things like that. So this was an idea about the classification, very helpful for your clinical practice. Here you see the Francis Classes symmetry of our ward for private patients. So it's nice, but in clinical practice, it's not very helpful. Identifying this deficit, I have developed and designed, and I've got a patent on these gafas de Miguelito. They're very light, they're simple, they're much cheaper than the other one. See here a patient with a vestibulopathia acuta unilateral. So the fast face is beating to the right. Which labyrinth is more active? The right one or the left one? The fast face, active labyrinth. Try to remember that. Maybe you have a similar bridge to memorize it in Spanish, fast phase to the more active labyrinth. Because the pathological phase is a slow phase. And if my left labyrinth is not working, my eyes drift to the left, and then you get a fast phase to the right. So fast phase to the more active labyrinth. Okay, and for those who would like to have all in your pocket, I have designed here this pocket guide with all the diagnostic criteria, the aspects of the patient history and the clinical examination for the vestibular and the ocular motor system, including these glasses. So I have 10 packages with me. If you like, you can purchase one. Okay, so now we come back to another study which is clinically very relevant. And it confirms what has always been my impression. The bedside head impulse test, we'll elaborate that later, is much worse than you think. So we did a study, 500 patients, 3 experienced examiners, and the sensibilidad was only 66% for relevant vestibular deficit. And our recommendation, as I pointed out before, and I can reiterate that, not often enough, is use the VU head. I can promote that because I'm not a shareholder of any of these companies, so it's neutral. So another thing we worked on was how useful are potential myogenico evocados vestibular cervical e oculomotor. Who is using the web of you? Can you raise your hand? Okay. So the most important indication, as you will see later in the lecture on laboratory examination, is syndrome de dehiscencia del canal superior. There it's part of the diagnostic criteria. But otherwise, it's limited. And the OVAMP, by the way, are the most sensitive and specific, as you see here, VAMP for syndrome de dehiscencia del canal superior. Another thing which we just finished, and the paper is in revision neurology, is a worldwide survey on normative and cutoff values. So all of you are using this or that laboratory test. By the way, who is already using the VHIT? Can you raise your hand? Okay, so this has to be tripled. Yeah. Tripled. You don't see how many up there. Okay. So, and the question is, what are the normative values? What are pathological values? And we have performed a worldwide survey, and there were also here 3 centers from Latin America, a web-based standardized survey questioning people here, Australia, Asia, Europe, the gringos, and Latin America. And at the end of the laboratory examination lecture this afternoon, I show you the devastating findings, showing a very wide range. So if you go to Dr. A, he says everything is fine. If you go to Dr. B, he says you have vestibulopatia bilateral. So this is a condition which we have to improve, and I'll tell you how to do that. Good. Who of you is using the dizziness handicap inventory? Okay, so I think you should not waste your time using this scale, because in this prospective study in 766 patientes, we demonstrated it's not correlating with semicircular canal function. It's not correlating with the VHIT. It's not correlating with calorics. It's not correlating with the C and the OVAM. It's not correlating even with posturographia. So don't waste your time on that. We don't have a better scale at the moment, but I think it's quite useless. Okay, some aspects update on disordines vestibularis perifericos. I'll show you the Simoprus maneuver based on a biophysical examination, and other aspects will be covered in the afternoon when I talk about enfermedad de Meniere and when I also talk about the pharmacotherapy. So this is a simple model which we used together with colleagues from Switzerland, and by using this model we have learned a lot about the pathophysiology of VPPV. One thing is, why do symptoms typically occur in the early morning? The patient gets up, turns around, has the first attack. Do we have an explanation for that in VPPV? So, the autoconia, these little crystals made of calcite, carbonate, bimorph crystals, they form a clot. And we could demonstrate in this model that the impact of the clot on the endolymphatic flow is much higher than single crystals. So that explains why the symptoms occur in the early morning. Another thing, and which has a relevance for the diagnosis and the treatment, is if you do a 90 degree turn, the clot does not reach the lowest point relative to gravity. And this is important for the diagnostic maneuvers and also for the therapeutic maneuvers, and the implication is then to have the Simoprus maneuver, which I can hardly demonstrate now here, because we have to overextend the patient's head, and this will be very difficult here. Somehow we manage that. Anybody who's very mobile and flexible? What about you, Signora? I just give you an idea how it looks like. Okay, you can sit here, take off the glasses. Okay, so normally when you do the diagnostic and therapeutic maneuvers, let's imagine she has a left-sided VPPV, you go down here and then you stop at earth horizontal. But then, as you can see in the model, the autoconia don't fall far enough downward. And therefore, what we recommend is, and that's now difficult here to manage, that you go beyond earth horizontal as much as possible. So this is not enough, but if you have an appropriate table, you can go down to 150 degrees or more. And we have just finished a three-center study with Belgium, Italy, and Germany. So the time it takes for a patient to recover in VPPV is only 50% with the Simoprus maneuver. And then you continue the regular way, there you go to earth horizontal. Okay, we'll just cut this. Okay. Por favor. Another thing is the duration, 60 seconds in each position. The model predicts what you intuitively do correctly. And the final thing is the angular velocity. There was a debate with comments from different experts. So the best velocity is between 90 and 180 degrees per second. This sounds theoretical, but this is what you intuitively do too. So major progress to increase the diagnostic and therapeutic efficacy of these maneuvers. Okay, another thing, what we do, you want to have an update, you will get an update. We do a genome-wide association study with all of our dizzy patients. So we have collected DNA from now more than 3,200 patients, and we looked for so-called single nucleotide variants which are related to various diseases. And this paper came out last year. We really found an association with the replication, the host factor for the replication of herpes simplex virus 1 in patients with neuritis vestibular. So here on chromosome 4, with a very high probability, and this makes it more likely that neuritis vestibular is caused by herpes simplex reactivation. Now we talk a little bit about vestibulopathia bilateral. Here you see again, the gain should be below 0.6 to make the diagnosis on both sides. Here are the criteria for probable vestibulopathia bilateral, and this is based on a bedside head impulse test. So this is different from the quantitative testing. So if you make the diagnosis, you need a VHIT. If you don't use the VHIT, you can only make the diagnosis of probable vestibulopathia bilateral. I explain that later. And Herman Kingma, a very kind colleague from Maastricht in the Netherlands, gave me his slides on the implante vestibular. And you all know the cochlear implant. And the analogous thing has been developed with sensores motoris, which have inertial sensors to detect three-dimensional head movements. The surgical procedure is very simple for experienced ENT doctors. You drill the labyrinth, which is dead anyway, and then you put into the three semicircular canals the electrodes. I do not recommend that this is done by urologists, but those who implant cochlear implants can do that easily. And it works amazingly well. And the other good thing is you need just one sensor and not two sensors, as we do because of the asymmetry of the vestibular system based on seconda ley de Ewald. So this system has no asymmetry. And here you see in blue the movements of the head. And in red, the compensatory eye movements between 0.1 and 2 hertz. If the machine is turned off, nothing. If you turn on the machine, then you see here in red how nicely compensatory eye movements are generated. So this system is so far used in the lab only, but I think in about 5 to 10 years we will get an approval. And patients, in contrast to the cochlear implant, don't have to learn. It's working from 1 second to the next. So. This is very, very promising. Good. And what also improves is so-called dynamic visual acuity. The patients with bilateral vestibulopathy often have oscillopsia. And here you can see how well vestibular implant works in red on and on motion. Dynamic visual acuity is within the normal range. So that's very promising. Okay, so this is now a summary, and if you like, you can take a photograph of that. So we went through the Clasificación Internacional, we talked a little bit on the diagnosis of nystagmus. I pointed out how important the VHIT is. Indications for VAMP are limited. Dizziness handicap inventory is not very useful. Here we have peripheral vestibular disorders and central vestibular disorders. Central vestibular disorders, I will present later the results of a randomized controlled trial. Episodic ataxia, famperidina, eazotazolamina are both effective in a similar way, not published yet. You will see the results, and we also talk about a nueva medicina para la ataxia cerebellosa. Last night I saw two patients, one from Córdoba and one from Buenos Aires. So a boy who was 1 year old and a girl. And another boy at the age of 9. Carlos did the translation into Spanish, and they all got the new drug. And the patient's organization is now working with the government to get an approval for the import of this drug from France. Okay, now I'd like to make a statement, a serious statement. Last year there was a meeting in Bogota related to Qatar. And I originally said I will participate, and then I said I will not participate for certain reasons. And then I heard some rumors that I did not participate because I was accused of harassment in Germany, not allowed to leave the country. And I heard that from some people. And you see here my four children, and I would like to protect myself, my children, and my reputation. And just to reiterate, there was nothing like that. So I had a lecture in Lima and in Panama at the same period, so I was able to leave the country. So if you hear these rumors, tell me who is distributing them, and I will sue him or her that he or she will not enter Europe. So just to take care of my reputation. Good. So since we have 2 or 5 minutes, I will continue with a video quiz. Those who have seen the event the day before yesterday, they already know the diagnosis, so you
are not able to participate. ¿Qué molestias le han traído aquí?
Tengo mareos, el peso se balancea y aturdimiento desde hace un año aproximadamente.
¿Cómo es por las mañanas cuando se levanta?
Nada más levantarme no tengo mareos, solo cuando salgo de casa. Y si pienso que ya estoy otra vez, es cuando vuelve a empezar.
¿Y qué pasa cuando tiene que concentrarse en algo de verdad?
En ese caso desaparece. Cuando uno está ocupado, no piensa más en eso y probablemente sea esa la causa también.
¿Y cómo es cuando hace deporte?
Cuando hago deporte también desaparece, por lo menos casi siempre, excepto cuando vuelvo a estar en el mareo. En ese caso, vuelve a empezar.
¿Y cómo es cuando bebe cerveza o vino?
Entonces suele desaparecer, también cuando estoy en compañía de gente.
¿Hay algo que reduzca los síntomas?
No, no lo hay.
¿Hay algo que lo incremente, como grandes almacenes, muchedumbres, habitaciones pequeñas,
no, no,
o espacios
nada de eso,
muy grandes?
No.
Para terminar, si tuviera que describirse a sí mismo, ¿cómo describiría su personalidad?
Sí, me concentro mucho en mí mismo y también me autodiagnostico muchas veces.
¿Cuál es el diagnóstico correcto? ABCDD. Okay, and that's also the new term, variofunctional, which is the umbrella of what has been previously called phobic posture dizziness, or the triple PD, the double PD, and things like that. So from now on, I strongly recommend that you use variofunctional. This term has also the advantage that it's neutral, that the patients can easily accept it, and it describes what the patients have. It's a functional disorder, and it's approved by the WHO. Okay, next patient.
In this patient, we test the somatosensory system by using our tuning fork. We put it on the sternum. Where do you hear the sound normally?
Left ear.
Now we put it on the medial malleolus. Where do you hear the sound?
Left ear.
So this causes an unusual symptom.
So how do you call this phenomenon? Autophonia, or as the Gregos say, autophony. Autophonia is Latin. That means you hear the sounds of your own body much louder. And this is typical of what? Yeah, syndrome de dehiscencia del canal superior. And that was a nice story, so that we could even publish that in neurology.
¿Qué molestias le traen aquí?
Puedo notar los movimientos de mis ojos en mi oído izquierdo. Es que los escucho.
Si tiene usted que llevar algo pesado o sonarse la nariz, ¿le produce molestias?
No.
¿Ha tenido alguna vez ataques de vértigo?
No.
So that was his primary history, and that's the reason why he was admitted to psychiatry, because this was misinterpreted. And if you let the patient press against the closed nostril, you will get a vertical torsional nystagmus, indicating in this case an excitation of the left anterior canal. So this is syndrome de dehiscencia del canal superior. It was first described by Lloyd Minor and John Carey and David C. About 2% of all of us, we do have a thin bone on top of the anterior canal. So the CT is not specific. And many patients have been treated with surgery, plugging the canal without having the disease. And therefore, we have new diagnostic criteria, which require also pathological OVAP. Here you see an intraoperative finding. You see here the missing bone. And you can also reconstruct the CT nowadays to resurface everything. That's one approach in addition to plugging. Okay, now a very easy case for you. Which type of nystagmus? Arriva. Okay, so this is in contrast to downbeat nystagmus of the transient phenomenon. It also responds to 4-aminopyridina because patients' ability to suppress the nystagmus by fixation is improved by this drug. The MRI is normal in most patients. Okay, next patient.
Señor Burga, ¿qué molestia le traen aquí?
Vengo a usted por una sensación de inseguridad cuando camino y mareos. Además, tengo la sensación de que la cabeza se mueve o bambolea constantemente, como si lo que veo se moviera constantemente.
¿Y cómo es cuando está tumbado o sentado?
En ese caso no tengo molestias.
¿Y cómo es cuando tiene que andar en la oscuridad?
Ahí también tengo problemas, ya que como he mencionado, no puedo orientarme con los ojos y entonces ya sí que no puedo andar más.
¿Y cómo es en terrenos irregulares?
Exactamente igual, me es muy difícil andar y el bamboleo es muy fuerte.
¿Cómo es cuando mueve la cabeza de izquierda a derecha rápidamente?
Exactamente igual, las imágenes
están... ¿Y cuando corre?
Lo mismo, pero hacia arriba y hacia abajo, es decir, el horizonte se mueve y no tengo una imagen clara de lo que tengo delante de mí.
Okay. A typical history of probable vestibulopatía bilateral. We don't have the results of the video hit yet. Okay. Another patient. This was taken by a CCTV camera in Istanbul. And there are 5 different diagnoses. I think the most frequent is demasiado enfermedad de compras, but maybe it's something different. So she's the patient. Like a 12 handbag, and then you have this abrupt fall.
Understood.
What is the diagnosis? Can be syncope, but she was also suffering from enfermedad de Meniere, Tumarkin's otolithic catastrophe. I'll show you later in my mid-year lecture the original paper by Tumarkin, and he called it catastrophe. I don't know who used the term crisis. Okay, so that was just a final warm-up for you to get your full attention for this hot topic. Muchas gracias por atención. Thank you.